So here's an issue that I see every once in a while where people use Java applications and they want each application to run in their own domain, each web server in their own domain. But because they use those period jar files, basically that is hard to do because those are interpreted by the Java executable file. And so domain transitions only happen on a on exec VE system call, so when an executable file is actually executed. So you can't actually define an extra domain transition for each jar node base. And so there's a workaround in Red Hat Enterprise Linux 6. The init system basically supports it, that allows you to deal with that issue. Unlike the init system in Fedora systemd, which is from that point of view a little less nice with regard to that. But anyways, I'm going to just actually demonstrate how you could deal with that, and I'll just set some settings. I'll just set up a new virtual machine for this because I don't have I currently don't have one, so that's what I'm doing. So it's setting up a new machine, but so basically what happens is that you have the system services and they all have our different Java applications, and it's just basically that single Java executable file that interprets all these web applications that are packaged in jar files. And those jar files aren't actually executed, they are basically just read by the interpreter, and the interpreter basically runs the application, so to speak. So let's just set this up real quick. At least as quick as possible, hopefully. This seems to take a little while. Well, anyways, I'm going to demonstrate how you can do that, how you can deal with those issues, because it's not only an issue with Java, or an issue and a gotcha for Java, but also for it could also be used in other scenarios. But Java is definitely the most common one. Same issue. Hadoop is also a Java thing, I think, and it's also implemented with the Hadoop security policy. So you can actually use that as an example as well. We're going to do that because I just know the concepts, but I don't know all the details. I'll just use the Hadoop policy to get inspired, so to speak. Europe, Amsterdam. A, B, C, 1, 2, 3. A, B, C, 1, 2, 3. And hopefully that'll use anyways. That'll start the installation entire drive. Hopefully it'll. So, but I basically I'm going to do this example based on a very simple Java application that I wrote. I'm not. It's really a piece of shit application. I just used Google to figure out how to get something to work, and hopefully it does work, because basically what it does, it just spits the security context of the process to the screen. And since this is a system service, going to be a system service, I'm not sure if it's actually. if I can get it to spit to the screen so that we can actually verify that it runs in the right domain. And we'll have to create some init scripts, I guess, and stuff like that. So it's really not very well tested. But that's usual with my demonstrations. It's basically I just have an idea and I'll just start the screen recording software and just start playing and tinkering, and then hopefully someone actually learns something from it or gets inspired by it. It's mostly also for myself, or not mostly, but for a huge part it's also just for myself. I just like to stay up to date and make sure that I know the things that I know are still applicable, and also some things that I want to basically extend my knowledge on a particular field. So this is a minimum install, so I'll update it first and foremost so that the packages are up to date, and then I'll also probably need to install the OpenJDK package, I guess. I've no clue, but I suspect that I'm going to need that. And it should be almost done. It's hanging on the SE Linux targeted policy, because that one is really slow in Red Hat Enterprise Linux. Fortunately, that has been optimized in Fedora, but in Red Hat Enterprise Linux 6, SE Linux policy installation updating and modifying is really slow. But at least Red Hat Enterprise Linux uses the old init system, Upstart or sysv init or whatever, which is really in some cases a benefit because it's much more transparent, or much more intuitive than systemd. Systemd is basically just one big suite of binaries that you have very little control over. Although I suspect that the maintainers of systemd will argue with me about that. But from an SE Linux perspective, the old init systems are more flexible. So yeah, it's booting up the system that I just installed. Root ABC123 and then yum install first NTP and ACPI, I guess, and nano is also handy, and those are probably the things that I like. Oh, and OpenJDK, but I'll just leave that for a second. These are just the base so that I can make sure that the time is correct and that I can basically boot the system from outside of the system with the ACPI daemon. And nano is my favorite text editor for stuff like this, for the simple stuff. It's slow, damn, I got a slow mirror. They have this plugin, Fastest Mirror, and it's actually written by someone I know, I guess. But it's just a lousy plugin. Actually, because this my connection is far more faster than 100K. It's just a stupid plugin. And I see that ACP ID wasn't caught. So yum install ACP ID, I guess it is. Determining fastest mirrors, yeah, bullshit. Yum update, hopefully it's a little bit fast. And no, it isn't. How lousy is this shit? Oh, this is a waste of time. Oh, right. Now it's faster. Taking another mirror, I guess. Now it's 3 megabytes. Don't want to waste too much time just update, just doing this, the basics. And yeah, now that's basically what we need. Upstart, so that's the init system that is used in Red Hat Enterprise Linux 6.4, but it's a modified Upstart, I think. It uses the old init script mechanism rather than the Upstart init files or startup files or event files, I think it's called, in the vanilla Upstart configuration. Anyways, 81 updates. And after that, need to reboot, and then I'll switch over to shell, to an SSH session, because that allows me to copy and paste stuff. And I am lazy, so all right, let's get this going. So again, it hangs on as a Linux policy. It's really a bottleneck in Red Hat Enterprise Linux 6, and that really sucks. Should have spent more time on optimizing that stuff rather than creating all these stupid scripts that basically make the S-Linux experience artificial. But oh well, I guess that's a matter of priorities. There's just different people with different priorities, and some people have more authorization, or I guess they have more, they are more saying in what happens. And of course the distro itself also has its priorities, so it's just kind of hard. Shut down, reboot now. And I'm just a hobbyist, so my opinion is not that important, at least not to the decision makers, I guess. Roots, ABC123, and then IP address show, and we have an IP address of 109, so let's just, oh, and don't mind the lag in my screen, because SSH roots 192.168.122.109, wasn't it? Yeah. ABC123. So you name all. This is Red Hat Enterprise Linux 6 up to date. Let's just check config NTPD on our, it's actually NTPD and ACPID, and then just service NTPD start, and it's probably NTP, oh no, it's actually NTPD and ACPID. Oops, unrecognized service, double D. And that doesn't actually grab ACPID. And it does run, so that's fine. So, alright, so let's just start getting this going. So I have these stupid jar files here. So we basically this CMD class, let's just slash that CMD class. Oh, it's It's a binary file. Oh, right. No. I mean, CMD Java. And on this shit here. I'll just copy that over. If I can find the terminal. I'm not sure where these things are usually placed, but I'll just place them in cd user share, oops, and then I'll just create it there, make there my app, my jars, cd my jars, and then inside there I'll just use it. So nano and then cmd, but I'll just call this jar1 java and paste that in and just modify it a little bit. So you have here class jar1 I guess, jar1, and then here's some stupid stuff. And that's basically it, I guess. And then I'll just remove this stuff. Let's see if that works, because it's just all stupid stuff. I could just basically remove this altogether, I think. My Java is really lousy, so excuse me. And I'll just call this option one, and this I guess, and then be able to use some stupid commands. I have it in my history. This is this. Here, jar command. So I'll probably need to install jar. What provide, and then a jar. What provides is one word. Oh no, speed up a little bit, please. Why is this shit so slow? Christ's sakes. I really hate that. 50K. This is in the 1980s. Okay, so that's not what I had expected, what I had in mind. Let's just where is jar? Or actually, that's not. So I'll just do that on the other. Where is jar? Christ. It's in user bin. So instead of this, I'll just use this. That'll. No match is found. Oh, Christ. No match is found. No packages. For Christ's sakes. For Christ's sakes. So are you telling me that OpenJDK isn't actually shipped? That's just bullshit. I guess we need EPL. Yeah, hurry up. And then release, I guess. 6.8. Is there a 6.4 though? So I guess this is it. Copy link location. RPM, UVH. And then, what provides? Oh, and it's not there. Not there, but at least I need to get that list anyways. Seems it's not finding it. What the hell is going on? Query is also not installed. Yum install yum utils or yum util. Now that's really shitty. Repo query all, and then just grab open JDK. Here we have it. So I guess we need that one and devel, I guess. Yum install and devel, I guess. Or actually might not need it. Jesus Christ, pulls in all kinds of shit. And of course it's slow again. So yeah, sorry about that, but that's just crappy. There's a CentOS issue. I should basically disable that stupid repository Fastest Mirror repository plugin, because it's just a crappy plugin. It's just a crappy plugin. This is gonna take ages. See, and then I hit Ctrl C and then it speeds up. That's stupid. Or maybe it's just a bug in Yum. I don't know what it is. Anyways, so let's see if I can actually. Get that stuff to work. Sorry, what was that command that I needed to run? I think this. Jar one, I guess. not found. Let's just Google that. What provides jar command Red Hat 6? Probably devel. Probably devel. So I'll just try it out because this is just a. This is just a test system, anyways. Hit Ctrl C to speed it up a little bit. Stupid. Press Ctrl C to speed up. Now it actually works. Oh, jar one class. No such file or directory. No. Jar one Java. Class jar one. Oh, let me guess. It's a difference in version. Please no. Why is it always so stupid? No such file or directory. Oh, let me guess. Or is this a stupid thing on my behalf? Yeah, this is it. So now I have this jar one. Now it should work, I guess. Java jar. Jar. And of course, class not found exception. Oh, and probably need to define that stuff. Crappy. Maybe I have that somewhere here. CP. Set directory my jars, use the shell my jars. Still doesn't work. Lousy. Class jar one. Yeah, this is. I should not have just do it simple way. At least. This is make it the way it was. That has worked. MV jar 1 Java CMD Java. And then RM jar 1 jar. And actually this was also not right. Just this one, I forgot this one as well. My Java is really lousy. And then I need to do some other stuff. My Java is really lousy. It's the first time I actually play with this stuff. Okay, and then that stupid command. Without the CP, probably needed. And now, of course, it's CMD. Now it works. So, that works at least. So I need to do the same, but then for another app. So, basically, nano CMD 1 Java, and go back and paste this over and just change the name to protect the innocent. CMD 1 Alright, so I got now two jars, I guess. So I'm going, and so basically both are just executed by Java. So you can't actually, these files aren't, these jars aren't actually executed. As you can see, there's no execute bit there. So they're just read by the Java interpreter. So you can't, and since the domain transitions in Linux happen on execute, so since there's only one single executable file, you can actually tell us Linux, okay, when this jar is run via Java, then use this domain, and when that jar is run, use that domain. So that's lousy. So, but since the issue is often that these jars are basically system services, you can work around that, and you could also work around it without actually without it being a system service by just wrapping it in a script. So basically you'll execute on an actual bash script, shell script, and then transition on that shell script, and then just run the Java command with the jar file. So that's one solution. But anyways, so with regards to those two being services, so let's just have a look at and I'll just ls etc rcd initd. Here you have a couple of services, so let's just see if we can find something a little bit easy. an easy script. Hopefully NTPD is rather easy. NTPD. Unless, let's see if it's, if we can use that. Then it doesn't look too easy. Although I can probably just remove a lot of this stuff. Yeah, I'll probably... I'll just use this and some modified, see if we can modify TP, then etc rcd init d, and then cmd1, and then just edit cmd1 nano etc RCD init B CMD one. Then just edit this. But I'll leave this comments. Or I'll just remove them. Actually, I'll just leave it in. So I'll just require those functions. I don't know why. Source configuration. I don't need that. Program CMD1, log file CMD1, I guess, and then start, and I'm not sure. I'll just remove these because it does need networking. So it checks user bin Java, I guess. File that we don't need that. Start daemons. Program. Oh, actually, program is Java. But I'll just. Where are those options specified? Actually, program is probably just Java jar CMD. Fuck. That sucks. Starting CMD1 and then daemon. Java jar CMD one jar, I guess. And stop. Kill proc. Sure, if this is going to work. Not very familiar with this stuff either, but I guess I could try it. Let's just first see if it works at all. Probably not. It actually works. Cool. So now you can see that it actually runs with the unconfined Java thingy. I'll just copy the this one to CMD2 and then just edit that. CP etc rcd init d the, and then CMD, I guess. And then just nano that last one and edit it. So this is actually CMD, and then this CMD, and then CMD. Seems to work. So these are basically just one shots, but it gets the idea across. Because so anyway, so let's, so now we have basically two init scripts that both run Java, both execute Java with different jar, reading different jar files, so it gets different instructions. So since we are domain transitioning on execute, we can basically transition on the init script and then make sure that each init script has a different type, and then we can use that to either also transition on Java itself to different domains, or just run the script itself in a in the script domain, but which is not recommended. So let's just go ahead and start. There are interfaces for that, by the way, so probably a good idea to just use the interfaces. Anyways, I guess we could create a policy module in the Citus directory. Make there my jars again. My jars. All right. So now we can basically use this directory to create a policy. So I guess nano my jars. Let's start with a file context file first. So we need to take care of the labels of the scripts, and yeah, that's basically all, I guess. So it's basically etc. RC and then escape the dot in RCD, and now init D, and then basically it's a CMD, and then gen context we're going to use readable policy system U object R, and then basically CMD init RC exact T. The boys outside are working really hard, the worker bees. That, so that's fine. So basically, this basically it for this file T. And now let's just declare a policy module first and foremost, and it's called my jars version 1.0. And then basically we need to actually think first. Let's just first, I'll just show you that example so that you can use that as well for referencing if you have questions or stuff like that. So I'll just open up my Eclipse browser, my IDE, and I have the reference policy repository clones somewhere here, and it's part of the reference policy. It's in the submodules, and then you'll basically look up the Hadoop policy module and just get inspired by how they deal with that stuff for your Hadoop. Hadoop, I'm already gone over it. So here's the Hadoop module, so I'll just open up all the files related to it. So this is a pretty complicated app. But anyways, we want to basically use this template and work on that. So we need an interface file. Nano my jars interface, and then just paste this in, and then just edit that. I'll just my example. It's not a very descriptive summary, but it's something. Template to create a to define a, I guess, my jars domain. My jars example. Stupid, but okay. And then we call this the my jars domain template. My jars domain template. So basically, what's done here is you get a type. So I'll just call this my jars. And then with the first parameter, which is a prefix, which we're going to have to specify. It's windy. It's hot today, but it's also windy. And the curtains are blowing all over the place. Need to keep that under control. So I'll just use the my jars attribute. Not sure if I need it, but I'll just my jars. And then we have a domain type, which is my jars variable 1t. And we have a domain entry file. Now here you have it. So we need Java executable file type to be an entry point. So you have a my jars. The entry point to the my jars underscore of variable 1t is actually the Java executable file. And then you have the init script, for which we already specified the file context. So my jars, and then I'll just use the my jars init rc domain. I'll edit it as well here. We're going to need to declare these type attributes. My jars. And yeah, my jars. My jars. Not sure if we are actually going to use these type attributes, but anyways. And here you have the init script domain interface that's called, and this is the interface that makes this stuff work. My jars. But I'll explain that a little later when it's all up and running, I guess. My jars. And you have a pit file, but we are not going to need, we won't need that. Log file, it's not, the script is, the init script is actually creating the log file, so actually in that case, yeah, we need the log file, I guess. My jars. Because the init script creates log file, but the init script is running in a separate domain. So my jars. So we want to create, we can create those with a different type. Yes. And the stupid thing is that I should check that out. Then you have this stuff here, my jars. Well, we're not going to use this stuff. Not yet, at least. And you have the my jars in it RC domain. But we are going to allow this stuff because the init RC process might want to signal the child. And we need to make a domain transition happen from the init script process type to the My, or yeah, the CMD process types, my jars. So basically the init script runs Java, and we want to tell SELinux, okay, when this init script runs Java, then the domain transitions to this domain, and when that init script runs Java, then the domain transitions to that domain. And here we have it, yeah, this my jars. I need to have a look at var log. And these aren't needed. Doesn't log, and it doesn't have a pip file, I think. Or does it? Not that I'm aware of. So let's just first check out the lsalz var log. And then was it subsys? Yeah, probably subsys. See, yeah, these init, these log files are still here. So what happens if I do service cmd stop? Fill, but did it actually remove those? But it did remove the logs, so that's fine. So I'm just that's just the main idea. As long as it removes the logs, then I'm fine with that. But yeah, the init script, it basically checks if it's running, and if it's not running, then it can't stop it. So that's why it says filled, because this is a short running process, not a long running process. But at least it did create or did remove the log file, so that's fine. That's what I wanted to do. I wanted to get rid of these two log files. So yeah, we have this interface file set up, so that works for now, or that should work for now. So we need to basically also take care of other stuff, and actually we need to edit the interface file as well. Well, I'll just copy this over and we'll just paste it in, but we'll remove most of it anyways, because this is such a large domain. And our example is really simple. So let's first edit the interface file again, because init script file. Yeah. Oh right. Yeah, my jars init script file. My jars, because we used it here, and we need to basically declare it, and we need the log file. My jars log file. And other than that, I don't think we need. Yeah, we need to require Java executable file type. Other than that, I think we're pretty much done here for now. T, and there's paste of shit in, but most of it can be removed. If not, yeah, I can do basically most of it. So we have these stuffs. So we need a my jars domain. We need a myjars init rc domain. We need a myjars init script file. And we need a myjars log file. That's it. Myjars log file. Then it's actually this stuff. We don't need this stuff. We don't need this stuff. We don't need this stuff. We don't need. We need none of this shit. And then you have CMD1 and CMD and CMD. So basically, we're now calling the template that we created in our own interface file. I really usually that's just not allowed because interface files are for external modules, and since we're using it only internal, it's actually not proper. We can remove all this shit. And actually we should probably remove everything here and just add stuff what we need later on. We just want to make sure that the domain transitions occur, that the base is set up. It's the most important thing for now. Oh, and it's not a Hadoop domain template anymore. It's now the myjars domain template, myjars. That's what we created in the interface file. Oops, myjars. I'm recalling that. These interfaces, or templates really. We're calling these templates, this template that we created in our interface file, we're calling it in our local type enforcement file, so that the rules in the template apply for the domain prefix of CMD and CMD1. We'll see about how that plays out. I'll probably need SLinux policy deval, let's just see, make f user share as a Linux policy deval. User share as a Linux deval, I think. Make file. My jars. And it's not found, so we need to install yum install as Linux policy. Oh man, this curtain is really annoying. It's like a fly that's on your ass. It's already up to date. Then it says as Linux policy is already installed. Yeah, but that's not what I'm asking for. Let's just ls all z user share as Linux. Oh, it's there. Yeah. I need make, I guess. Yum install, and not just that, I probably need a lot of other stuff. Why doesn't, that's a shitty thing in Red Hat, you don't have to actually explicitly require make. It's expected to be on the system, but that sucks because this is a minimum install, and so it failed on make. I needed to actually install make because as a Linux policy doesn't require make. Really stupid. Anyway, so we did that. So let's install that. SE module I my jars EP. Gonna take a little while because it's slow on Red Hat Enterprise Linux 6. C'est la vie, I guess. It's really good weather outside now. They say it's a tropical day, but it's not that hot, but the sun is shining and stuff like that. For September it's great. So we have a issue here. Could not convert to SID, so I made a mistake. Let's have a look at our file context file. CMD1 init rc. And that's actually my jars. My jars. See if that works. See, the type that we were using in our file context file was not the type that was created by the my jars domain template that we created in our interface file, because we use a basically a template type, which was basically a my jars and then the parameter one and then init.rcxt, so it was not cmd init.rcxt, but it was actually my jars underscore cmd underscore init.rcxt, blah blah blah. Restore gone R V F etc R C D init D. So now it's basically reset the file context of both the init scripts. So now you can see that my jars cmd init rc is associated to the cmd init script, and the my jars cmd1 init rc exact init script is associated to the cmd init. So you have different types there, and there are now rules that basically tell us things. Okay, when init runs cmd, which is labeled with this type, then domain transition to the myjars underscore cmd underscore init rc underscore t domain type. And then there's a rule that says if myjars underscore cmd underscore init rc underscore t runs a executable file with type java exact t, then transition from myjars cmd init rc underscore t to myjars cmd underscore t. We'll see how that happens. So now we're going into development mode, set a force 0, and just see if that actually pans out. So let's just service, and actually we are going to use run init just to be sure. Run init service cmd start, and I hope it's installed. ABC123, and it failed unable to access jar file, but that's weird. It used to work, and it's probably interesting. Oh, yum. Install PostgreSQL utils Python, and it's probably because it has a different environment or something like that, or maybe I'm just making. Nah, I don't think I'm actually. I wonder why that is. I guess we need to specify the path or something like that. Jesus Christ, this is also taking long. Everything as Linux related is slow as shit. It probably wouldn't have expected me yet that I say that, but I'm just telling you like it is. In EL6, everything as Linux related is slow as shit. Okay, so auto to allow again. Now we have at least some stuff, so we can see what's happening here. This isn't even getting out of. Actually, it is. It is actually getting out of the init rc domain. See if the log file is there. The worker bees are very active today. No, log file isn't created. Let's just see if. Unable to access jar file, CMD jar. I guess. No, no. ETC. It's RC. In it. CMD. I guess we need to specify the full path to the jar file. User share my jars. User share my jars. Christ. These worker bees. I would say someone give him a job, but they already have a job. That's why they're making so much noise. My jars. They're mowing the grass. I'm not sure if you can even hear this, but it's very annoying. The worker bees are mowing the grass for very little wages. They're working really hard for very little pay. They have no choice. They don't have a choice. Now it's running. And now you can see that the command for the myjar1 service is actually now myjar1. So if I now start myjar itself without the 1, then you see that it runs in a different domain. See? So the myjar, the CMD runs in CMDT, where the CMD1, and it's the same jar file. It's the same jar file, but it's just different domain. And this is a nice way, because now you actually don't have to mess with stuff too much. You just create a okay, and all right, so they're gone. And now basically I have to allow it to get the shit going. It's probably pretty many rules. See? Alas. So there's so many rules because actually it's I think these rules with regard to it searching the domain types and reading it is basically it's getting state, and that's basically in its script where it's basically killproc. This is basically killproc. I think it's actually just going berserk searching for a proc with a particular name, and because it can't find it, it just goes berserk. But we can just deal with that and allow it, I guess. Or just don't audit it. Let's just don't audit it. So that's a simple rule that can get rid of all this stuff at once. So I'll just add that for both the CMD and the CMD1 init scripts. So you can basically write a rule that applies to both of them, to any of them. So let's just go, and I should probably append this to my jars just for reference purposes. So that I don't have to look it up every time. So here they are. So there's a simple rule. So now we can actually write different rules. So we can basically write rules that apply to all and to some. So what you get is, for example, this block has local policy that applies to local policy for all my jar script domains, and then for only my jar CMD domain script domain, my jar CMD script domain. And then this is one for policy for only, Christ's sakes, for only my jars CMD1 script domain. We probably won't be even using this stuff, but just so that you can see how you might order that stuff so that you can find it. And then this is policy for all my jar domains, so not the script domains but just the my jar domains, and then policy for only my jars CMD domain. Just for yourself, just so that you can find your stuff, know where you put your stuff when it either applies to all or to a single domain. And this is local policy for only my jars CMD one domains. And then remove this shit. So these rules that for my jar CMD1 init RC basically apply to both, because we know that both scripts are actually the same. Both jars are actually the same. And both init scripts are also actually the same, except that one is pointing to CMD1 jar and the other is pointing to CMD2 jar, but they basically do the same thing. So yeah, we can basically just use that. So we can get rid of a lot of stuff. For example, the first thing is we have this kill proc going berserk. So what we're going to do is we're going to allow the both script domains to actually read their own application state, which they are probably already allowed. Well, we'll just do that. So we're going to copy one of those over here and then just put them in place that apply to both script domains. And we're going to just write a rule. And actually this is better off in the interface file, because if we would do this, if we would say allow all my jar script domains, which is here my jars init RC domains, to search my jars domains, then that would be too coarse, because one script could search the other, and so you might not want to do that. So let's just copy this over and add this to the interface files. Copy. Christ sakes. Oh, this is annoying. But if I don't open the windows, and I'm going to be in a furnace. So I'll just save this one for now and then go to the interface file. And you have the same deal here. So basically what you can say is in an RC policy, you can basically say read own state files, and then just paste that in this, and then just change that. So you can say this stuff, you can make it like this, and that'll allow only CMD1 to read the CMD the my jars. State. Only to read their own state, not each other's state. And then that's now they can both these init scripts can read their own state, the state of the CMD jar processes. And then we go back to the type enforcement file. And now we basically add a interface call that applies to both the init script processes, and that's a domains don't audit read all domain state, and it's actually domain state, I think it's probably this one here, and then we're going to call that for the my jars init RC domain, because this attribute was assigned to both the init script domain type. So rules that are called by this attribute apply to both of them, to all of them, actually all of the ones. If you create new domains, my jars domains, then this rule automatically will apply to them as well. So that takes care of a shitload of rules here already. So for example, this can be removed. This can be removed. This not. This we need this. Console type, we need that. This can be removed. This crond process. DHCP process is trying to read state. Getty process is reading state. Init state. Init RC state. I'm not sure what runs init RC. Kernel states. Local login states. And this is locale. Localization files reading it. We need to allow that. NTPD states. And it's actually executing Plymouth. Can you believe that? I'm not sure why that is. Probably some stuff. Here it's reading proc, generic proc stuff. And it's actually SysP tracing. So that's that script doing that. That init script. Can you believe that? Those functions that I include in that script do all kinds of nasty things. Oops, fuck. Shit. Sorry about my language. But this is a movie for adults. This isn't for kids. And this SE Linux stuff isn't for kids either. And this stuff, and this can be removed altogether because it's just the same. And this is also just the same, as you can see. Both do exactly the same thing, so you can just remove that. So basically now we need to just take care of this stuff. So what it does here is it's actually both of them are actually executing generic binaries, and I wonder what that is. It's certainly not Java. And we could look that up, by the way. Let's just do that. I forgot still crap bin T, but it's already passed, so I need to 1325. So we have it. So and now we basically need to grab init RC. So here we have it. See, that's that function shit. So it's running the CMD command, and the CMD command is actually generic. And actually, that's not true. I'm lying. So the function, this script, the function script is binti, I guess. Yeah, that's it. So let's verify that. And that's why it needs to, yeah, see, that's binti. So that's why it needs to execute. It's actually executing this script. Actually not executing it. That's weird. No, it's not executing the script itself. This is, it's just sourcing the functions. But inside that script, all kinds of generic binaries are used. So, for example, touch and pit off and stuff like that. So that's basically why it needs to run generic binaries, because of the functions file. Inside the functions file, there's all kinds of generic binaries being executed, pit off and touches, stuff like that. So we just need to allow that. Yeah, so that basically applies to also cd and then basically core commands, and then exact bin, just let them both my jars in it rc domains execute generic binaries, so that they can basically do the pit off dance and stuff like that. But they can't actually do it fully, because we basically silently denied the access to read all system, all domain states. So they can't. The pitoff command is probably trying to read all the domain state files to determine which process to kill, I guess. But we don't allow that. We only allow process with its own process type to do that. Which aren't running at that stage, because it's a short running process. It's just a simple command. It's not a long running process. So, anyways, we can remove these two, and then we have the console type that's executed. And it's probably also something in functions, but this is optional. If you don't have the console types command installed, or you don't have the console type policy installed for some reason, you don't want to install that, then you might not have it. So we need to make that optional, so that our policy won't depend on that. Console type exec. And then it applies to both my jar script domains. So that's optional. So that's a dependency way to deal with dependencies, because this might not be there. So also both scripts need to read localization. So that's misc files read localization. Misc files read localization. And that's basically this one here. Also applies to both scripts, to any my jars init rc domain. Okay, the next is, this is locale, so you can remove that. Blindmouth, I'm not sure about the interface name, but it's probably Blindmouth exec. Let's just make that optional as well, because you might not have Blindmouth installed, or the Blindmouth policy installed or enabled. Blindmouth exec, and it applies to both my jars script domains. And that should take care of the Plymouth. And then you have it's reading generic process state files, so mem info and stuff like that. That's something that Bash does. So that's basically kernel read system state, and we're putting that all the way on top for some reason. It's a style rule, kernel read system state, and it applies to both init script domains. So they can both read proc mem info or proc CPU info or whatever. It's generic process state files. And then we have this thing, this capability sysp trace. Now I don't know what the fuck that's all about. But I'm going to allow it anyways. And all the way on top. And then we just basically replace this type with the attributes so that it applies to both my jars in the RC domains. And it needs to be allow, not low. And then we have it executing a shell. And that's probably just for the function file. It's just running a bash shell. So that's core command exec shell. Damn. Give me a break for once. Core cmd exec. Oh, and this is wrong. Core cmd exec shell. And it applies to both my jars in its script domains. Take care of that. And then basically this one, it's writing to the user dev PTS. And that's basically, and this is probably, this should probably be improved. Because I'm running this, so let me explain what it happens. So I'm running the service cmd start, and it returns the jar files, return the process the process security context to the screen. That's what you see. That's how I can verify that they're running the right domain. So it's basically writing to your terminal, but it's the user dev PTS terminal, because I'm running it manually. By if I run the service command as the normal user, but if the system just starts automatically, then it won't be printing to the user dev PTS. Then it will be printing to I'm not actually sure what it will be printing to, but so I need to actually it could be printing to console. I guess it's, yeah, I guess. But anyways, we're just going to allow this for already, and then after that we're also going to allow other stuff. So how do we allow this? User DOM use user users, user terminals, I think. If it doesn't build, we'll see it. This is just from intuition and from experience, and the benefit of if you're using consistent naming of your types and your interfaces and your attributes and stuff like that. User DOM use user terminals, I think this is it. It might not be, but this will not be sufficient if you basically set this service to auto start and then reboot. Then you'll probably see it trying to write to another terminal that is not a user terminal, so we'll have to deal with that. All right, so we took for to a large extent care of this stuff, so let's just take care of these here. So these basically apply to both the things, but here's an issue. So it actually creates a file in temp. Can you believe that? It actually creates a file in temp. So we need to create a new type. Let's deal with that first. So we need to create a new type in our interface file. And so we'll attribute my jars, and we need to actually declare that my jars temp file. And then you don't need to specify attribute here, so just new attribute. And then basically just create that. So I'll just borrow this shit here. My jars temp file. fill my just empty. So we need a file type transition here. File stamp file. So that'll allow us to do take care of that. And then basically can we also borrow this shit. But this is actually not for here. You, I will just paste that in here. You, and change the domain type to actually the my jars type, not the my jars init.rc type. And then you get files empty, and it's not a files log file trans, but it's a file temp file trans. That should take care of that stuff. Let's just double check that. Is it only a file? No, yeah, it's only a file. Because it doesn't actually create a temp either, it just adds name or removes name. So that's fine, this is fine. So we took care of that, we need to actually declare that type. So here we my jars temp file. Type attribute, sorry about that. And actually we don't even need that attribute. But we did that, we declared it for just for shits and giggles. So anyways, now we need to local policy for all my jars domains. So they all need to execute bin. So core cmd exec bin, and then it's basically my jars, my jar, Jesus Christ, my jars domain, I guess it was, wasn't it? If not, we'll see. And here you have an actually execute node trans. So in that's basically optional as well. So optional policy. And it's basically, this is basically Java executing itself. But since Java is optional, you might not have Java, although it doesn't make sense because this app definitely depends on Java being there. So actually this is not optional. Java exec, because if you don't have Java installed, then it's game over anyways. My jars domain. So it's not optional, you'll depend on the Java module. And then it's misc files read localization, so they all want to read localization files. Misc files read localization. My jars domain. Domains, I think. Let's have a look. No, my jars domain. Stupid. Inconsistent. You really need to be consistent, because else you'll be looking up shit and you think, oh, did I use domains or domain? Or if you be consistent, then you'll just can guess it right. But it's hard to be consistent. Kernel reads system state. It reads generic proc files, so that's proc mem info and stuff like that. And can you believe it actually needs exec mem? Basically all that the script does is print out the security context, and it needs exec mem for that. Jesus Christ. Kernel read system state. And maybe it's just my bad programming. Because that script, it has a few lines, but it's probably not right anyways. It's probably not a proper Java app. Java programming skill or a development skill is really sad. So yeah, basically they both need to execute anonymous memory for some reason, which sucks. My jar domain, or my jars domain. And then it's basically lists sysfs dirs. Not sure why that is. And I think it's fs list sysfs, not sure. Fs, actually, Reed Sisyphus. Death Reed Sisyphus, I think it is, actually. Death Reed Sisyphus. Actually, let's do Death Reed Sisyphus, because it's actually not reading it. It's just reading the dir. And by reading a dir, so it's basically reading, searching and opening the dir. That's basically just listing it. So it doesn't actually read any files in there. At least, so not so far. And then again, we have that stuff where it wants to print to the terminal. So that's user DOM user terminals. And then, oh, the smell of cut grass. The lawnmowers were just came by, and the windows were open, and now the smell of cut grass is nice. So yeah, that's basically. This is basically the initial policy. So let's just build that, see where it gets us. Where is the damn makefile command? We have a syntax error. Plymouth exec. So that's then probably Plymouth D exec Plymouth. Stupid. Consistency issue. Stupid is that. But I still know what it means by just see it. That's just experience. I just know all that stuff. SE module I my jars. That's just see, I know that stuff, but because it wasn't consistent, because the naming wasn't consistent in some way, I guessed it wrong. But I see the compilation error, and I think, okay, so that wasn't consistently named, so it must be this. Another semi-consistent naming, and that's actually pretty funny. The way I actually, how that goes in my head, how I reason. So yeah, actually now it's done. So basically, Senforce 1 should, in theory, and let me be clear about that, in theory take care of this, but in practice it probably won't. So run init service cmd start abc 1 2 3. See, it still fails. That's why I said in theory. Let's have a look. I'll search MACDS. This is also something that the policy developers know. So there's this command SEModuleDB. I'm not gonna explain it again. But basically, there's some shit, probably some shit silently denied. So we need to expose that, so that we can figure out why what is denied, what should be allowed. But someone in the policy outer of the main policy was probably don't out it happy, so to speak. He wanted to deny something silently that he shouldn't have. And that's why we're basically stuck with this situation. So let's try that again and then see if something is logged. ABC 1 2 3, and then I'll search again. Now something is logged, but doesn't seem to be. That's funny. That's funny. Audit to allow. Let's just see if this is at all related. See, my comments, some stuff is silently denied. It should be silently denied. But there might be exceptions, especially with this Java shit. Might there actually be an exception? So we need to add this to the interface file. And just see if that makes it work. look at this extended stuff. See if this makes it work. And if it does make it work, then we should narrow it down. See what actually causes this. But this is probably due to my bad coding. Something like that. Might just be. But I'm not saying, I'm not claiming to be an application developer. I just did that because I just created this app or this stupid script to just show you this stuff. And actually this is also a why you need SE Linux, because well, these applications might be buggy as shit and you might wanna see. So there was actually, because we're in a forcing mode, there was actually one of these, and these usually, these permissions usually should be unaudited. Now the problem for us is that we need to narrow it down. We need to actually figure out what it is, what it actually is. Let's also do an out search again, just to be sure. Chips. This is all crap that we all need to take care of, and here we have actually my jar's reading security. So this is actually something we need to deal with. Let's have a look. A lot of stuff that we need to deal with yet. Oh, and there's actually an interface file. Damn, there we have the lawnmower again. So here, oh, this is actually not it. Here we actually allow it to, or we actually silently deny it reading the system state. The problem is that before it reads the system state files, it's actually traversing the system state directories. So we actually need to basically see if this works. Get attributes. See if this builds. No, it doesn't. Search, let's try to see if search works. And else we're going to have to look it up. Yeah, but that works. So yeah. Intuitive, inconsistent. There's the lawnmower man again. And then as a Linux read FS, I guess, because it's for some reason it's reading the SE Linux FS here, security FS file. So we can look up what that means, what it's actually reading. Grep security FS T security T. It's actually reading the MLS file, and it's the ID command that's actually doing that. So we should probably just allow that. It's not terrible. And that's SE Linux readfs, and which domain is it actually? The normal domain, because the normal domain runs. So it's actually SE Linux readfs, and that's probably wrong. Yeah, that's wrong. I'll just look that up. So it's in the SE Linux module. it's in base, as Linux manual is in base. So modules, policy modules, and then kernel, and then as Linux. And then there should be some interface here. And it's basically what it does is reading the fs, remount fs, unmount fs, get attribute fs, don't audit get attribute, search fs, don't audit read fs, get enforce mode. So I guess this is what we need. And we could basically probably use this, but it's not. I just allow this because it's probably just a library function that needs it, but I don't like don't auditing stuff if it's not strictly needed. So I'm just going to allow it. But you don't have to allow it if you don't want to. It probably works just as fine without this permission. At least in most cases. But I'll just allow it. I'm not using SE Linux just for the sake of using SE Linux. Okay, so now we're back to that last issue. So we have these three stuffies here. And I'm just wondering what it is. Which one of them is it is? So I'm just going to comment or copy this one, and just comment out the above, the first, and then just try it out. So let's just assume that it doesn't need the resource limit inheritance. Now, if that's true, then it's going to work. This is basically a pretty lot of work just to see what it needs. It might, chances are that it's stuck on the no at secure, not sure, but I don't see this often. It's probably just due to my bad coding skills again. And then the service start again. That's wrong. So this one is not it, because it works. So that one wasn't needed. So let's go back to our interface file and just see if it's signal inheritance, because I think it's just no at secure probably. So I'll just go with what I think is right. Else it's going to need signal inheritance. It could be signal inheritance. I think actually it is signal inheritance, come to think about it. No, it isn't. Okay. Okay, whatever. If it's not that, then it's not that. That's fine. Okay, so we took care of that. Basically, it just needs the no at secure for whatever reason. Or maybe it was just failing on... And I'll just remove this comment because it's obvious. Maybe it was just failing on some other permission, but anyways, this should get us going. So let's just make it again, install again, and now just should just work. But we need to also check whether it works and how to make it work when you boot. So we need to verify everything. So let's just get enforced to make sure that we're enforcing. We're enforcing. Let's just start this application. ABC123. And it's starting and it runs in the right domain. Let's do the same for CMD1. ABC123. And it's starting with the right domain. So let's stop them both. And CMD1. And then OutSearch MAVCTS 1416, I guess. And we still have a lot of shit here. Yep. That's weird. Oh right, we're still with SC module DB. So we need to undo SC module DB. That's stupid. So we're still exposing the hidden denials where we shouldn't. So that's why, so always think about that stuff. So if you I'll search ABC 1419, it's clear. Wait for 4020 and just try it once more, and then you'll see eventually it should be all clean with a where it properly works. And then we need to reboot, see if we can get it to work on a clean boot as well, because it needs to print to the screen, and if you boot cleanly then it needs to print to a different terminal type, and we need to allow that. So started ABC 123 and stop it. And then use the outsource command to see if it's clean. And now it's clean. So now we're right. So now we basically need to reboot. Fuck, I need to throw that lighter away. It's empty. So yeah, let's just check config, and then it's CMD on CMD1 on check config list grep CMD. So they're both on in run level 2, 3, and 4, 5. So that this is shut down, reboot. And then just check AVC denials again to iron out the last ones, the final ones. See, it's not going to be able to print to the screen now because it's denied. So yeah, that's obvious. So login and OutSearch. So you have it. Some of the finals. And actually, it's now also it's trying to create a deer. Shit. What a mess. Aha. That's weird. So it's creating that AS spur further. Anyway, so with regard to the terminal, see, it actually needs to read the console device rather than the user DevPTS. And that's what I was referring to earlier. And that's term use console, I guess. Let's just do with this first. Build it and just manually verify that so that we don't have to reboot again just to verify it. The boys are noisy. So then just basically see if it can actually read-write the console device character file manually. So the search command allows you to do that. The search allow source and then just copy over this stuff here. And then target console device, copy this over. And then for T character files, CHR file. As the search is not installed, yum install as the tools, and it's not called console, is it? It's also it actually is console. Nice. And I'll try it again. And it actually returns a rule. So that's allowed. So now we have to deal with the dir actually. And let's do an outsource again. So it's actually also creating a dir. So we need to just deal with that. And we can't use a name file transition though, fortunately. So we just have to deal with that shit. Nano. My jars. Interface file. So it's not just a file here, it's also a dir. And I dirs parameter. And also we need to allow that default transition on the dir. And that takes care of that. And then just, I'm not sure if these, let's see if the log files are there, because I'm not sure if it was probably able to start. I'm not sure. ls var log. Subsys. Yeah, so we need to run init. And I'll show you why you need run init. Service. CMD stop A, B, C, 1, 2, 3. Oh, and that's the wrong password. A, B, C, 1, 2, 3. And same for CMD1. A, B, C, 1, 2, 3. So, well, we know that we, if we use the run init command, it runs in the right domain. So let's just try this without the run init command. Service CMD start. See, it starts, but it runs in the wrong domain. You see? So, and that's because it actually, yeah, that's actually just wrong. So how do you deal with that? Now, that's an interesting question that I haven't actually dig in a lot. But we could figure it out, I guess. And this, that's going to be hacky. What we should probably do is what you should probably have is a admin for these services. So let's just set that up. Although I must say that that's quite messy as well. Probably for another example, for another demo, for the next session. But this is just proof that it won't work if you don't use run init. You really need to use run init, because else it's going to end up in the wrong domain. And maybe I'm just going to take a break right now, because we set up, we confined the script, and it works. But there are buts and ifs, and this is definitely something you want to be very careful with, because admins will not do this properly. Actually, let's just hack it in. I'll just hack it in. So what you basically need to do is, and this is actually really a hack. It's actually really a hack. So I'll just I guess this is it. So we could hack this in, but this is really, 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 really nasty, and this is not something I recommend. You should just be clear to the admins and say, okay, you need to run init, because else it's not going to work, and you need to make sure that these guys understand that and don't make stupid mistakes. But you could hack some stuff in like this, for example, type unconfined t, and I'll probably roll unconfined R somewhere, roll unconfined R, and then what you need is actually, let's see what that was. See, it actually did already roll transition, but it just didn't type transition. So that the road transition we don't seem to need. That's a plus. So we need a domain transition. So DOM trans pattern. And let's see what's happening here. Unconfined T. And then we actually need two rules. My jars, or actually not jars, S1 init RC exactly. My jars S1 init RC T. Let's see where this gets us. You actually don't need a role transition. The role transition is happening for some reason. And we have an issue here. Conflicting. Yeah, this is just not going to work. Let's just try. No, this is not going to work. And that's due to the init script domain. So this really sucks. It really blows. And you could hack around this. I can hack around almost everything. But it said in it, it's just this stupid one. So if we look that up, but I'm just opening up a huge can of worms in its script domain. So here you have it, what's in there. So they are basically applying some attributes in there, to there. One to the first parameter, which is the domain, and the other to the second parameter. And then there's a rule that basically allows unconfined T to. Transition to init RC on init script types. Now, the hack around would be to not classify it an init script file type. However, that could cause other issues. But let's just try it for the sakes of. Just for the sake. So we're just going to not use this type attribute here, but we're going to need these type attributes. This is rather nasty. just rather nasty. We probably also want to take care of sysadmin in case someone decides to use it. See if this builds. And then you'll also get the issue that you'll probably need initRC explicitly as well. Let's just see if this works first. Nope, it doesn't. Why not? I hate that when everything needs to be explicitly exposed. So much activity going on outside. These guys are really slaving like a... like I don't know what. Why is that? That is strange. No ABC denials whatsoever, so let's just set them for 0. But this works. What do we have? We have this one here. Good job. Let's auto to allow that. Yep, we have this. We need a role transition now. We need a role transition. So it's really ugly. But let's just work around it. Where is my interface? So let's work around this. We need to also allow init D. And now we basically need a role transition. So we need to also have a role here. And confined R. So, role transition. And then when sysadmin sysadmin r, uncle find r. Process. Oh, actually, you don't need to do that. Actually, I think. And then we can use the init scripts, the my jars, init rc. Init script file. Init my jars. Init scripts. Jesus Christ, the noise. And then system R. And all requires system R as well. And it's actually these curtains. The noise, the curtains, the heat, it's all messed up. Uncle find r sysadmin r and system r. These guys are such lowlifes outside, these painters. We have an undefined sysadmin r. Why is that? Let's have a look. Oh right, I forgot a comma separator. Duplicate role transition. Why is that? This is a duplicate role transition, that's what it says. Duplicate role transition for unconfined. So it wasn't actually it was just prevented, I guess. So let's just see if, for example, we all want to the domain system change exemption, I guess. And we need a couple of rules here. So it says this is already allowed. So, or this is already specified. So maybe this, then add these rules in here. Domain, system change exemption. Maybe it's just this. This is already allowed. But this might, yeah, this is probably also allowed. It's weird. Let's just try this. Might not work on attributes. There's always, or there's usually some way to hack around it. Yep. Oh shit. Wrong command. Oh. The smell of paint gets me high. We have painters outside. They're painting the building. Been painting it for the last couple of weeks. So there's a lot of disturbance because they start very early in the day and they're noisy, and then you have the smell of paint all day, get you high, and you have these lawn mowers mowing the grass all day. Guess they don't have anything better to do. Same with these painters. The doors were painted a couple of years ago. There's nothing wrong with it. But I guess they need to have something to do, so they're painting it again in a different color. Stupid. Okay, so service, start, and I'll get a force. Set a force one, service. What is it? What's called CMD start. Now it works. So now it actually runs in the with the system R role in the right domain. But there's other issues here. Now we need to also see if that works when you reboot. Because the system also needs to transition now. So let's just shut down, reboot. Actually, let's do module B first. And then just reboot and see where, if the system brings it up properly. It's kind of hard to determine, but hopefully I'll be able to determine it. Shut down, and I'll stop this one as well first. But shut down. Good. This is really a hack. Really, again. You should just tell your admins to do it right, because now you're basically hacking up the system quite a bit. At least not that much. This is still doable, but it's still not normal. It's already done. Last far log. Audit, log. That's the tail. Uh, seems odd. Ships. This is still and 20 less that. Or actually, don't need less it. Any APC denials here? Doesn't look like it. Yeah. Now all of a sudden it needs to write to death PTSD. But the transition did happen. Audit to allow and capital R will try and translate it. So yeah, we're getting pretty deep into this stuff right now. Oh, and it's actually CD user share Linux. Actually user share my jars, and then nano, my jars, TE, and then just add that in as well. So it's not just console shit that it needs to write, but also PTS, generic PTS. So yeah, it's a little ugly, but oh well. Make F. It seems to work, and at least now it works for normal users as well. So now you don't have to use run init anymore. But yeah, it comes with a cost. But yeah, we had to hack it up quite a bit. Now you get all kinds of stupid dependencies and shit. Kind of. Well, not really, but kind of. But yeah, there's a solution for every problem with SE Linux. Almost every problem. Just need to be creative. Damn these lawnmowers. Okay, so let's less var log messages and see if there's something in the logs with regard to the service. There's nothing. It doesn't look like it. What do we have here? We have some messages, but that's 40. Yeah, that's pretty recent. This is old stuff that no longer applies. The messages that you see for the context invalid stuff, we dealt with that. Let's just try it. Service start, restart, I guess, or actually stop first. Stop. What was that? What were they called? CMD, eh? CMD. Let's CMD stop. CMD one stop. As all C var. It's a lot of testing to get it right. Oopsies. And then start. And it just runs in the right domain. So it just works. It just works. So yeah, this is it. And then when it comes to confining administrators, you have to basically use the same kind of tactic. You need to these role transitions to happen on the init script file of types. On the types used in the init script. So basically what we hacked around was we removed the init script domain and we basically cloned it a little bit, but we removed one type attribute that was assigned to it. So that made it so that there wouldn't be another rule overriding these rules, the role transition rules and the domain transition rules. And actually this DOM also needs to so now sysadmin2 also doesn't have to run that stuff. But you also want init to be able to transition. And this here is probably it's kind of a duplicate. And maybe not even needed. I'll just put that below there so that you can see it. Anyways, this should be about it. Let's see if it still builds, and if it does, then I'll just leave it at that. So that's how you deal with your jars. If you want to have each jar in a different domain, then either make it system service, and if it's a user application, just wrap it in a script, in a shell script. So just create two different shell scripts, each running Java with a different jar, and then domain transition on the shell script rather than on Java. So yeah, that's it. That's all I have to say about this stuff. It's nice. The init system is nice. It gives you that flexibility. If you take for example systemd doesn't actually run init scripts. It has these unit files that just get interpreted by systemd, so that you can't transition on your unit files because they're not executed. So that just sucks, because if you have one unit file that runs yeah, or two unit files or whatever, or 100 unit files that run the same command, you can only specify one domain transition, because well, the source is just a single, it's just systemd, and you can actually apply what we did right now to that situation. Now there are workarounds, and those workarounds are really ugly, so yeah, you can actually work around that issue, but it's really ugly, just the same way that systemd is in other ways also really ugly. So yeah, sure, systemd might be a bit faster, maybe not, I'm not sure even about that. It might be new and shiny, but if it was up to me, I'd take Red Hat Enterprise Linux 6 with as Linux optimized, so that it isn't slow as shit as it is now, and then with the named file transitions implemented, which is implemented in Fedora, and then I'll take Enterprise Linux 6.4 over systemd every day, because 6.4 is really a pretty nice release. But there were some issues with SE Linux where it's slow, and also some functionality is not implemented with the named file transitions, so you can't actually transition using additional file names to instruct SE Linux to transition and stuff like that. So, but otherwise, EL6 is a really nice system. So yeah, I'm gonna leave it at that because I can talk about this stuff all day.